as we use the prayer printed in the bulletin, and let us confess and ask God's forgiveness and guidance. Together.
Dear God, how are we kind of all we see, grace beyond all we know, love before all we need. We cannot comprehend it or imagine. We only know your presence in our lives. You knew us before we were born. To you who realize us after our last breath. We cannot accomplish your glory. Instead,
hear and believe the good news of the gospel. God forgives us. God redeems us. In Jesus Christ, we are made a new creation. Let us give thanks to God. Amen.
Recite them to the children and talk about them when you are
at home and when you are away, and when you lie down and when you rise. The next scripture is Luke 22:39-42. He came out and went, and it was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached
the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed. "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done."
Aye, aye.
Romans 8:26-28. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God. We are called according to his purpose. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I am wrapped up and yesterday on the grave route, I was bouncing around like that, and people thought I was crazy. Okay, I just lost my wind socket, and there it is. So I think I need a little prayer. Dear God, we do ask you to bless us, be with us, inspire us, help us to hear whatever it is you want us to hear and to respond as you would have us to. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God is with us, and God is good all the time. This is the second sermon in the series on the Lord's Prayer. We will focus on the three opening requests in that prayer that we are very familiar with. These three are all focused on God, obviously, but even more precisely, focused on God and pointing us toward God's complete control in our lives, God's love in our lives, and God's calling us to be faithful people, a faithful person in God's plan. So complete control is what God calls. We are asking God in these three petitions, and again, they are, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. They are the petitions referred to by commentaries as the thy petitions. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So all of these phrases focus on God and try to call us to giving God complete control of our lives. We're asking God in these petitions to help us remember who God is, basically. That's what it's saying. To offer our lives into God's plan and God's control. It's about trusting God. All of these are about asking God to guide us. So the first of the phrases, hallowed be thy name. It's probably the least understood of the three. Hallowed is not a word we use these days, but we know it means holy, God as holy. It is sometimes also translated as honored, revered, sanctified, or made holy. Now here comes the challenge. Of course, God is already holy, the most holy of holies. We cannot make God any more holy than God already is, and nothing that we say or do can make God more holy. So what is this request saying, hallowed be thy name? I read a little book, as I've been reading along, about the Lord's Prayer, and this little book was about it was an interview with the current Pope, Pope Francis, who says, what we're really doing is we're asking God to manifest that holiness in us, to make us aware of that holiness of God that already exists. And not only for us, for me and you, but really for everyone. We're asking God to show us that holiness. Be holy for me, God. Be holy for us. Be holy for all who turn to you, even those who don't. Be holy for everyone in the world. That's kind of what we're asking. Show us your holiness, God. That's what we're saying. William Berkeley, who you will have heard a lot about and hear more about, writes a commentary, and he says that we are praying when we say, hallowed be your name. We're really saying, show the world who you are. Show the world who you are in your holiness. Well, that would be pretty wonderful to see and experience the holiness of God. The power, the majesty, the mystery, the greatness, all that is God. Wonderful. And if you're a little bit honest, a little bit overwhelming and frightening, as well, to be in the powerful presence of God. Holy means other, set apart, different, higher, even distant. In the Old Testament, there is a greater awareness of this holiness of God. In the Old Testament, it's even expressed as awe or fear of the Lord. And throughout the Old Testament, there is more of that awareness of this power that is God. God is powerful, and God is not to be messed with because of that power. Don't take God for granted. God is mighty, and God can do whatever God wants to do. Now, in the New Testament and in our lives, the love of God balances this distance for us. And as we draw closer to God, we are balanced by the love of God and the power of God. So it is not quite as dramatic in some of our opinions, some of our feelings. But the holiness remains. Don't take God for granted. God is mighty. God is powerful. I talked last week about the word Father and the nearness of that name, the way that name brings God near to us, and about the word heaven and the way that is more implies distance from us and things we cannot understand about God. In this phrase, hallowed be thy name, we remind ourselves of the reverence that God deserves. We remind ourselves of all that God is, all the wonder and all the power and all the love. We remind ourselves also all that God expects of us as we say, hallowed be thy name. For God's name to be holy, we must honor God. And not just by words and phrases and praises and worship, but by our actions that demonstrate our faithfulness to God. For God's name to be holy, we must live holy lives and honor God through those lives that we live. The holiness of God must be made real in us and in our actions in the world. So this first petition of the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be thy name, reminds us to honor God in all that we say and all that we do in the world. The next phrase, thy kingdom come, is a little harder to understand. For one thing, we don't have kings or kingdoms these days, and those kings that are in the world are not the same as they were in biblical days. We don't think about what it means to be ruled by someone else, or as the biblical days, to even be owned by someone else as a slave. We here in America are proudly and blessedly independent, and we determine our own destinies and our own allegiances. When the Bible speaks of the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, we know this isn't talking about a physical place. We know that this is talking about a realm in which God is in charge. That's what the kingdom of God is, where God is completely in control. God making all the decisions and all the movements in the world and in our lives. God having all the power. That's what we're speaking of when we speak of the kingdom of God. We talk about belonging to God and following Jesus, but our familiarity with this language has weakened the power of what we are really saying. Our belonging is more than family and connection. To belong to the kingdom of God is to owe everything in our lives to God and every allegiance to God. To do what God wills, to serve God, to allow God to make all of our decisions and to follow where we think God would want us to do, or for us to make all of our decisions in light of, based on, what we believe God wants us to do. God as sovereign ruler, Jesus as king, these are not just names or descriptions. When we pray, thy kingdom come, we're saying, push back every other kingdom, push back every other realm, every other allegiance, and every other power that there is, anything that might control us or entice us or enslave us, push those back. We are even asking God to push back our own independence, our own freedom, and to take charge of our lives. If we belong to the kingdom of God, then God is in charge. We are praying that God be our only source, our only provider, our only guide, our complete guardian. Let us belong to God. Let us trust God with all that we are and know that God provides everything that we need. We are praying, let God rule us and our lives. Are you ready for that? Are we really praying that? When we pray, are we really saying, Christ be my King? God, take over my life. Thy kingdom come. In some ways, the third petition is an extension of the other two. Knowing who God is, the holiness of God, the power and the love of God, and knowing that we belong to God and God's kingdom and God's realm of power, it follows that we pray for God's will to be done. Thy will be done. We pray for God's will to be our will, for the wisdom and to recognize God's will, for the courage to choose God's will, for the ability to do what God would have us do. That's what we're praying. We pray to put all of our other desires in tune with God's desire, God's will. Again, give up control, giving ourselves to God, our will to God's will. But this petition goes beyond just ourselves. We pray, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. This means we pray not only for our understanding and our obedience to God, but that the entire world understand and become obedient. That the entire world comes to know God, comes to understand God's will, and comes to follow God's way. The whole world, on earth as in heaven. Many believe that this phrase, actually, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, that this is actually a petition pointing forward to the end of the world, the end of time, when every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, when everyone on heaven and earth will come to know the true, holy God. We're praying for God's victory, even God's final victory, for God to set everything right, as we know God can, and only God can. All three of these petitions about God remind us of who God is, and that indeed God will win in the end. We pray that with confidence. Perhaps we pray for that final victory to come quickly when we pray this prayer. As a beginning, we pray that we become a part of God's great plan now. That we personally, each of us individually, and we collectively become a part of God's plan. That we serve God well and faithfully. That we do God's will. Thy will be done on earth in me, God, and through me for the rest of the world, for others. I mentioned last week that the final phrase of the Lord's Prayer, for thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever, that part was added in the early church to the biblical record that we have read as a closing benediction, for thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. And you will notice that this threefold benediction corresponds to these first three thy petitions. So the prayer closes by reminding us where we started. The holiness or glory of God, the kingdom of God here and yet to come, and the will or power of God in the world and in our lives. So thy kingdom come, the power, thy will be done, and the glory, the hallowed name of God. It's all there from beginning to end. And Jesus taught us from the very beginning to focus on God, to remember that we belong to God, that we seek to understand God's will. We trust God, and that is where all prayer begins and ends, in trust, confident in God's love of us, in our God who loves all. So may we always find our way to such prayer by the grace of Jesus Christ. Yeah. guide you, remembering all we know of who God is, to confess what you believe in this God. I invite you to stand and join in the Apostles' Creed as found in the bulletin or slides. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born under the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
seated. And as you came in, you should have picked up self-serve communion. If you didn't, you may remember that congrats song at this point. Wait to open it until I get to opening and pouring myself. So. God, who is infinite, eternal, and unchangeable, reaches us and calls to us, revealing love and truth. And we know this, God. We are invited to come into the presence of this unknowable God and to get a glimpse of eternity. At this table, we foretell a marvelous banquet feast at the end of time as we come into heaven, when all people of all times and all places will gather and will be received in God's grace and will celebrate as we have never celebrated before. But today we get a glimpse of that celebration. God's kingdom come. God's will done on earth. So all are welcome at this table. Everyone may receive the gifts of God's grace and share in the fellowship that God has given us. Come, let us celebrate this feast and let us pray together. Mighty, merciful, glorious, giving, transcendent, and imminent God, we thank you for loving us, for reaching out to us, for revealing yourself to us. We thank you that in Jesus Christ you came to earth to live among us, to show us what love looks like, how love lives, where we should follow. We thank you that Jesus taught and touched all who would be disciples. And we thank you that we too are called to serve the world in your love. These elements today of bread and juice remind us of Jesus' life on earth, of his sacrifice for us, of his death at the hands of sin, and of our redemption from that sin by your actions in Jesus Christ. We remember also Christ's resurrection to new life and your promise to all who believe that we shall rise also. By these gifts of bread and juice, by these reminders of sacrifice and redemption, we pray nourish us with your grace, pour your spirit over us and into us that we may see and serve you clearly all our days. Strengthen us for the journey ahead. Fill us with your spirit. Inspire us to see you, to understand your will for us and for your world. Help us to follow Jesus as we step out into the world, teaching and touching and healing and helping, learning and loving every single day in a million different ways. Show us how to help those who are in need. Show us how to share your grace. There is much we do not understand. Today we see in a mirror dimly. Help us to see you face to face, even now, and to be your people. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray as he first taught his disciples. We pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, This is my body broken for you. Do this remembering me. In the same way, Jesus took the cup after supper and said, This cup is the new covenant filled with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this remembering me. So that every time you eat of this bread or drink of this cup, you proclaim the death of our Lord Jesus Christ until Christ comes again in glory. These indeed are the gifts of God for all the people of God. Let us give thanks. You may feel and share the bread first. Let us praise God. Let us pray together. Glorious and gracious God, close to us as breath, distant from us as heaven, you speak to us in mysterious ways. You inspire us. You help us to understand. Lead us now to be your people in the world, sharing grace, hope, love, in the name of and after the way of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore. Amen.